Dear friends, I am Dr. K. Kannan, Professor Mechanical Engineering, Anjaliyammal Mahalingam Engineering College, Koyilvanni. I am going to discuss through this video lecture on the GATE question paper, Graduate Aptitude Test in Engineering. So, in the lecture series, I am going to discuss the questions from the question paper, GATE question paper, which comes under the following topics: thermodynamics, thermal engineering, gas dynamics, heat and mass transfer, fluid mechanics and machines. I have the collection from 1992, question paper, GATE question paper from 1992. And I prepared the solution for my regular class teaching that I want to upload for the benefit of the mechanical engineering students. And for each question, so I will give the solution, and wherever required, we will discuss. So if it is a multiple choice question that does not require any explanation, we can directly pick up the answer, right answer. And if there is a numerical example, then I will solve the numerical example and then we will pick up the correct answer. And other objective type, multiple choice, fill in the blanks or numerical problems or match the following, all the questions will be solved. So, which is coming under the topic thermodynamics, thermal engineering, gas dynamics, heat and mass transfer, fluid mechanics and machines. So, now nowadays the GATE examination is almost it becomes mandatory for all engineering graduates. So, based on the GATE examination score only, you can get the PG admission in the government, reputed government institution, and based on the GATE examination will be, you will get the appointment, you will get the interview call from the national level companies. And once you have a GATE score, that indicates you have very good knowledge on the mechanical engineering subject. So, for the mechanical engineering graduates aspiring for GATE examination, GATE score, I think these lectures will be very much useful. And so, we straight away get into the lecture. So, the first lecture, it is from the question paper 1992. I give the question and then I will give the correct answer. So, wherever required, I will give the explanation. Alcohol are unsuitable as diesel engine fuels because the Ct number of alcohol fuel is very low, which prevents their ignition by compression. The Ct number of alcohol fuels is very high, which prevents their ignition by compression. The Ct number of alcohol fuels is constant, which prevents their ignition by compression. None of the above. So, diesel engine is a compression ignition engine. So, at the end of the compression, the fuel, once the diesel is injected, because of the temperature of the air, the diesel starts to burn. So, that is what compression ignition engine. So, the self-ignition temperature of the Ct number of the fuel should be low, and the self-ignition Ct number of the fuel should be low, which prevents the ignition by compression. So, the Ct number of the fuel of this alcohol, it is very low, so which prevents the ignition by compression. So, normally for diesel fuel, the Ct number should be higher. So, self-ignition temperature that will promote spontaneous ignition in the diesel engine. So, the correct answer is Ct number of alcohol fuel is very low, which prevents their ignition by compression. The second question, boiler rating is usually defined in terms of maximum temperature of steam in Kelvin, heat transfer rate in kilojoules per hour, heat transfer area in meter square, and steam output in kilograms per hour. Rating of the boiler. So, normally the rating, if you look at the steam power plant, 100 megawatt steam power plant, 200 megawatt steam power plant, 500 megawatt steam power plant, they are available. So Naval Lignite Thermal Power Corporation or Ennore Thermal Power Plant, NTPC Power Plant, they are rated with the power output, so in megawatts, kilowatts, but that is not available here in the list. So in the list, among the parameter available in the list, the best answer is the steam output in kilograms per hour. So the amount of steam output coming out of the boiler, that is the best answer among the four answers here. In steam and other vapor power cycle, the process of removing non-condensable is called scavenging process, de-aeration process, exhaust process, and the condensation process. So in a vapor power cycle, we are using condenser. We have boiler, turbine, condenser, and the pump. So condenser is one component in the vapor power cycle, any vapor power cycle or steam power cycle. In the steam power cycle, Rankine cycle, the condenser is operating at a pressure lower than the atmospheric pressure, the vacuum pressure. We call it as lower than the atmospheric pressure as a vacuum pressure. It is operating at a vacuum pressure. So because the pressure inside the condenser is less than the atmospheric pressure, there is a possibility of air leaking into the condenser through the mechanical joints in the condenser. So the air inside the condenser is to be removed, right? So the otherwise the performance of the condenser will decrease. So the air is to be removed. That is why all the condenser, they are attached with their vacuum pump, which will be operated periodically to remove the air. So this process is called as de-aeration. So the right answer is de-aeration process. So the process of removing non-condensable in the air, the main non-condensable is air in the condenser, because atmospheric air will leak into the condenser. So the correct answer is de-aeration process. The next question, the brake thermal efficiency of the three types of reciprocating engine commonly used in road vehicle are given in the increasing order. So two-stroke SI engine, four-stroke SI engine, four-stroke CA engine. Two-stroke SI engine is very popular in the two-wheeler. Four-stroke SI engine, four-stroke CA engine, they are very popular in the four-wheeler, even light-duty, heavy-duty vehicles. So the increasing order, two-stroke SI engine, four-stroke SI engine, four-stroke CA engine, two-stroke SI engine, four-stroke CA engine, four-stroke SI engine, four-stroke SI engine, two-stroke SI engine, and the four-stroke CA engine, finally, four-stroke CA engine, four-stroke SI engine, and two-stroke SI engine. Now, we have to compare two. One is two-stroke engine, four-stroke engine. So, among the two engines, four-stroke engine, they have better efficiency. So, four-stroke engine. So, the answer, actually, increasing efficiency. So, lowest efficiency will have the lower efficiency. Two-stroke engine will have the lower efficiency. So, the answer starting with the two-stroke engine is correct answer. So, A and B. There are two options now, A and B. Among the A and B, now you compare the SI engine and the CA engine. So, petrol engine, diesel engine. So, petrol engine will have the lower efficiency than the diesel engine because of the lower compression ratio. So, four-stroke SI engine will have the lower efficiency than the four-stroke CA engine. So, the correct answer is two-stroke SI engine, four-stroke SI engine, and four-stroke CA engine. That is the efficiency, it is in increasing order. So, the two-stroke SI engine will have the lowest efficiency, then four-stroke SI engine will have the higher efficiency, and four-stroke CA engine will have more efficiency. And the subsonic and the supersonic diffusers have the following geometry, divergent and convergent respectively, both divergent, both convergent, the D convergent and divergent respectively. So, we will see the subsonic diffuser. So, we look at the Mach number. Mach number is less than 1. It is subsonic. Diffuser is a device which is increasing the pressure with a decreasing velocity. Whether this is subsonic or the supersonic, a diffuser is a device which is increasing pressure and decreasing velocity. So, look at here. Pressure is increasing, velocity is decreasing. This is Mach number is less than 1, it is subsonic diffuser. We have another device. So this is Mach number is greater than 1. So supersonic flow device. Supersonic flow device. Once again, pressure is increasing, velocity is decreasing. So this is also diffuser, supersonic diffuser. So this is subsonic diffuser, this is supersonic diffuser. So this is diverging part, diverging area, this is converging area. So the answer is divergent and convergent respectively. So subsonic diffuser will have the diverging passage, supersonic diffuser will have the converging passage. The following is the arrangement for of rotary pumps in descending order of specific speed at their best efficiency. Descending order, decreasing order of specific speed. So positive displacement, centrifugal centrifugal pump, actually rotary pump, all the rotary pump. So positive displacement rotary pumps are gear pump, van pump like this. So positive displacement pump, centrifugal pump, axial pump. B, centrifugal pump, positive displacement pump and axial pump. C, axial pump, centrifugal pump, positive displacement pump. Axial pump, positive displacement pump and the centrifugal pump. So specific speed range, specific speed value. So look at this table. So this is the specific speed of different pumps. So axial flow propeller pump 100 to 425, mixer flow pump 70 to 135, radial flow pump maybe 10 to 70. So here in this list, we do not find any positive displacement pump. So the positive displacement pump is not in the list. So the higher specific speed is axial flow pump. Second is mixer flow, radial flow, they are centrifugal flow. So second is centrifugal flow, then finally positive displacement flow. So the answer is axial flow pump, centrifugal flow pump and positive displacement pump. Then the theoretical mechanical efficiency of a jet engine neglecting frictional and thermal losses when driving a vehicle has its maximum value. Efficiency will be maximum when only when the vehicle at the sonic velocity moves at the sonic velocity. B, when the outlet gases approach zero absolute velocity. C, when the vehicle speed approaches the magnitude of relative velocity of gases at nozzle exit. And D, only when the relative velocity at nozzle exit is at its maximum. The answer is the C, when the vehicle speed approaches the magnitude of relative velocity of the gases at the nozzle exit. And next question. The jet pump, it is fluid mechanics, jet pump are often used in process industry for their higher efficiency, easy maintenance, large capacity, capacity to transport gases, liquid and then mixture of both. So the jet pump, the main use when actually it is working on the jet principle. So the from the outlet of the jet pump, certain quantity of liquid is taken and then it is brought back to the nozzle diffuser, I mean a nozzle is there, the nozzle creates the pressure drop. Using the pressure drop, the water is pumped. So the jet pump main advantage is capacity to transport gases, liquid and then mixture of both. So this is the reason why it is often used in the process industry, because of this reason. Two rods, one of length L and other of length 2L, are made of the same material and have the same diameter. The two ends of the longer rod are maintained at 100 degrees Celsius. One end of the shorter rod is maintained at 100 degrees Celsius while the other end is insulated. Both the rods are exposed to the same environment at 40 degrees Celsius. The temperature at the insulated end of the shorter rod is measured to be 55 degrees Celsius. So the temperature at the midpoint of the longer rod would be, we have four answers. So A equal to 40 degrees Celsius, B equal to 50 degrees Celsius, C is 55 degrees Celsius and D is 100 degrees Celsius. So the correct answer is 55 degrees Celsius. We will see how. So this is the shorter rod of length L. One end is at 100 degrees Celsius, other end is insulated where the temperature is measured as 55 degrees Celsius. So this is the longer rod of 2L length. So both the ends are maintained at 100 degrees Celsius, both the rods are exposed to the ambient at 40 degrees Celsius. So for the first, for shorter length rod, we calculate the temperature distribution. So the temperature distribution of the fin, end insulated fin, are T minus T infinity divided by TO minus T. So T is the temperature at a given location, T infinity is the environment temperature, TO is the base temperature. is equal to cos h m l minus x divided by cos h m l. So we calculate the temperature at x equal to L. So at x equal to L. So that is 55 degree Celsius. So we know the temperature. We substitute the temperature. So T equal to 55 degree Celsius. The surrounding temperature is 40 degree Celsius. The base temperature is 100 degree Celsius. And the right hand side, cos h m x equal to L, L minus L equal to 0. Numerator is cos h 0, cos h m 0, that is equal to 1. Denominator cos h m l. So the numerator is 15 by 60 equal to 1 by cos h m l, or cos h m l equal to 1 by 4. So 1 by 4 equal to cos h m l. So this is the solution from the shorter rod, smaller length rod. Now we use this answer here. So the for this rod, we have to calculate the temperature at the midpoint, mid location, where x equal to L again. So T minus T infinity divided by TO minus T infinity equal to cos h m L minus x divided by cos h m L. So temperature at the midpoint we do not know. T is the unknown. T infinity is 40 degrees Celsius. TO is 100 degrees Celsius. This cos h m 0, this numerator is again cos h m 0 divided by cos h m L. So cos h m 0 equal to 1 divided by cos h m l. So now the numerator T minus 40 divided by 60. So from the previous solution, 1 by cos h m l equal to 1 by 4. So T minus 40 divided by 60 equal to 1 by 4. And solving this, T equal to 55 degree Celsius. So that is the answer we have selected here. So answer is 55 degree Celsius. The fluid flowing over a flat plate has the following property. Dynamic viscosity is 25 in 10 power minus 6 kilograms per meter second. Specific heat is 2 kilojoules per kilogram Kelvin. Thermal conductivity is 0.05 watts per meter Kelvin. The hydrodynamic boundary layer thickness is measured to be 0.5 meter. The thermal boundary layer thickness would be A, 0.1 meter, B, 0.5 meter, C, 1 meter, and then D, none of the above. So we have to calculate. So we are given the thermal hydrodynamic boundary layer thickness. So from that we have to calculate the thermal boundary layer thickness. First we calculate the Prandtl number. So Prandtl number equal to Cp mu by K. So Cp is 2000 into 25 in 10 power minus 6 divided by 0.05 equal to 1. So Prandtl number equal to 1. So delta T equal to delta. So the thermal boundary layer thickness equal to hydrodynamic boundary layer thickness delta divided by Prandtl number to the power 0.33. So equal to 0.5. Prandtl number 1 to the power anything equal to 1. So this equal to 0.5. The answer is 0.5 meter. So when the Prandtl number equal to 1, thermal boundary layer thickness equal to velocity boundary layer thickness delta T equal to delta. That is also another conclusion. A condenser of a refrigeration system rejects heat at a rate of 120 kilowatts, while its compressor consumes a power of 30 kilowatts. The coefficient of performance of the system would be COP equal to A 1 by 4, B 4, C 1 by 3 and D 3. So we have to calculate the COP and we are given. So we look at the refrigerator. So this is the refrigerator. So it rejects heat from the, they extract heat from the low temperature reservoir. T2 is low temperature, T1 is higher temperature. It extracts heat from here, from the refrigerator space, and it rejects heat to the surrounding. T1 is the surrounding temperature, W is the work done. Now we are given heat rejected. So heat rejected is given. So Q1 is given as 120 kilowatts and the W is given as 30 kilowatts, power equal to 30 kilowatts. So W equal to Q1 minus Q2. So Q2 equal to Q1 minus W, which is 120 minus 30 equal to 90 kilowatts, and COP equal to the heat extracted Q2 divided by W, which is 90 divided by 20, 120 equal to 3. So the correct answer, the COP equal to 3. Then a steam turbine operating with less moisture dash more or less efficient dash prone to blade damage. Moisture content, normally the steam is operating, the steam enters the steam turbine with the superheated steam and leaves with dry steam or wet steam with the higher dryness fraction. So wet steam means it has moisture. So the less moisture, so when you have lesser moisture, the efficiency will be higher. So the more efficient. So when there is more efficient, when there is less moisture in the gas steam turbine, so the moisture will damage the presence of moisture will damage the blade. So when you have lesser moisture, there is a less damage to the blade. So the answer is less here. So a steam turbine operating with less moisture is more efficient and less prone to blade damage. Blower delivers gaseous fluid at the pressure ratio below or above 1.15 and dash either have or have no artificial cooling system. So blowers normally they are operating around 1 to 2 pressure ratio. Pressure ratio will be around 1 to 2. So when they are normally the blower they are not used for they are in the blower we are not using any artificial cooling arrangement. So the artificial cooling is used only in the turbines, I mean gas turbines, right? Not even in the compressor. So the below is the answer here and have no artificial cooling arrangement. So blower delivers gaseous fluid at a pressure ratio below 1.15 and have no artificial cooling arrangement. A refrigerator compressor designed to operate with R22 cannot be operated with R12 because the condensing pressure of R22 at any given temperature is higher or lower than that of R12. The answer is refrigerator compressor designed to operate with R22 cannot be operated with R12 because the condensing pressure of R22 at any given temperature is higher than that of R12. Match the instrument which has physical quantity they measure. Instruments are Pitot tube, Magliard cage, planimeter and LVDT. The measurement are RPM of the shaft, displacement, flow velocity, vacuum and the surface finish area. So the Pitot tube is used to measure the flow velocity. So Pitot tube is flow velocity. Magliard cage is used to measure the vacuum pressure. Planimeter is used to measure the area and LVDT is used to measure the displacement. So the RPM of the shaft and vacuum they are extra. And now the questions from the 1993 gate question paper. The gas turbine cycle with the heat exchanger and reheating. So the gas turbine cycle with the heat exchanger and reheating improves only thermal efficiency, only specific power output. Both thermal efficiency and the specific power output, neither thermal efficiency nor specific power output. So D is not the relevant answer. So D is immediately neglected, rejected. So gas turbine with the heat exchanger and the reheating. So reheating, heat exchanger means regeneration. When you have regeneration and reheating, so the answer is the thermal efficiency and the specific power output. So both are increasing. So that is the objective of installing a heat exchanger and reheating in the gas turbine cycle. Knocking tendency in a SI engine reduces with increasing compression ratio, wall temperature, supercharging, engine speed. So knocking tendency will be reduced. So knocking tendency will be reduced with increasing. The answer is compression ratio. So round the clock cooling of an apartment having a load of 300 megajoules per day require an air conditioning plant of capacity about 1 ton, 5 ton, 10 tons and 100 tons. So 30 megajoules per day require the plant capacity. The answer capacity equal to 300 megajoules per day. So 300 into 1000. So convert into kilojoules per day divided by 24 into 60 into 60. This is equal to 3.47 kilojoules per second. So that is the heat to be removed per second. So we have 1 ton of refrigeration equal to 3.5 kilojoules per second. So the amount of capacity, so 3.47 divided by 3.5 equal to 0.99 tons, which is 1 ton. So the answer is 1 ton. The capacity of the plant record is 1 ton. Radiative heat transfer rate per unit area in watts per meter square between two planes parallel gray surfaces. Emissivity equal to 0.9 maintained at the 400 Kelvin and 300 Kelvin is 992, 812, 464, 567, and now we have to calculate a simple equation. So Q by A radiation field transfer, Q by A for gray surfaces, sigma into T1 to the power 4 minus T2 to the power 4 divided by 2 by epsilon minus 1. So because the emissivity of the both the plates are equal, so 2 by epsilon minus 1. So substituting sigma equal to 5.67 10 power minus 8 into 400 to the power 4 minus 300 to the power 4 divided by 2 by 0.9 minus 1. So calculating, this is 812. That is the answer. 812 is the answer here. The use of refrigeration 22 or 22 for temperature below minus 30 degrees Celsius is not recommended due to its good miscibility with lubricating oil, poor miscibility with lubricating oil, low evaporating pressure, high compressor discharge temperature. So the answer is high temperature discharge temperature. So the discharge temperature of R22 is quite high, hence the degree of superheat in the system using this refrigerant should be minimum. That is the explanation for the answer. The answer is high compressor discharge temperature. Next question, the equivalent evaporation in kilograms per hour of a boiler producing 200 kilograms per hour of steam with enthalpy content of 2426 kilojoules per kilogram from the feed water at a temperature of 40 degrees Celsius. The liquid enthalpy of water equal to 168 kilojoules per kilogram. The enthalpy of evaporation at 100 degrees Celsius equal to 2258 kilojoules per kilogram. So the answer is 2149 kilograms per hour, 1682 kilograms per hour, or 1649 kilograms per hour. So equivalent evaporation, we calculate the equivalent evaporation. So equivalent evaporation, ME equal to M into H minus H of 1 divided by 2258. So M is the mass of the steam produced, H is the enthalpy of the steam, H of 1 is the enthalpy of water, and this is the constant. So enthalpy of evaporation until 100 degree Celsius. So calculate, substituting M equal to 2426 minus 168 divided by 2258, that is equal to 2000. So the answer is 2000. The current carrying wire of 20 millimeter diameter exposed to air, so with the heat transfer coefficient H equal to 25 watts per meter square Kelvin. Maximum heat distribution occurs when the thickness of the insulation is K equal to 0.5 watts per meter Kelvin. So what is the critical thickness of insulation? So 20 mm, 10 mm, 2.5 mm and 0 mm. So the critical thickness of critical radius of insulation RC equal to K by H, which is 0.5 divided by 25 equal to 0.02 meter. So thickness equal to critical radius minus the radius of the wire. So diameter of the wire equal to 20 millimeter, radius equal to 10 millimeter. So 0.02 minus 0.01 equal to 0.01, which is 10 mm. The answer is 10 mm. Cavitation in the hydraulic turbine is most likely to occur at the turbine. So in the case of turbine, the cavitation will occur at the exit. So now there are three answers, exit, stator exit and rotor exit. The correct right answer is rotor exit. So the cavitation will occur at the rotor exit of the hydraulic turbine. The specific speed of Kaplan turbine is in the range between 30 to 60, 60 to 300, 300 to 600, 600 to 1000. So look at this table. So the Pelton wheel 8.5 to 30, Pelton wheel with the two more jet 30 to 51, Francis turbine 51 to 225 and Kaplan turbine 300 to 860. Or 300 to 1000. So the answer may be D, 600 to 1000. The specific speed of the Kaplan turbine is 600 to 1000. So the thank you. So we'll meet in the next lecture.